It was the largest, deadliest war in history, World War II. It spanned the globe, produced destruction on an unprecedented scale, reshaped the future of the world, and cost millions their lives. It put 16 million American men and women in uniform, left more than 670,000 Americans with wounds and injuries, claimed the lives of more than 400,000 Americans, and for almost 4 years, consumed the days of countless American civilians who worked and sacrificed to win it. Finally, after years of bloody warfare, it ended in victory by Allied forces under American leadership. In the late 1930s, the Axis powers, Imperial Japan, Nazi Germany, and Fascist Italy, unleashed mighty invasions against their neighbors and plunged the world into war, inflicting immeasurable suffering and death. Axis forces were initially successful, making staggering gains against the Allies in the Pacific, Europe, and elsewhere. Then the tide turned. Imperial Japanese forces were decisively defeated at the Battle of Midway and were forced to begin a long and bloody retreat across the Pacific toward the Japanese homeland. Italian and German forces were defeated in North Africa by Allied armies, then in Sicily and in Italy, where the Italians surrendered and were compelled to join the Allies as the Germans fought a stubborn withdrawal up the Italian peninsula. Meanwhile, Soviet forces drove the invading Nazi army from Russia and back toward Germany, while bombers of the U.S. Army Air Force rained devastation on Nazi military and industrial targets, and Germany's once powerful North Atlantic submarine force was ravaged by constant Allied search and destroy tactics. Still, the people of the world watched and waited for an Allied invasion of France, a breakthrough strike against Adolf Hitler's mighty Atlantic Wall, which stretched from Norway to Spain. Finally, on June 6, 1944, the Great Invasion was launched. It was codenamed Operation Overlord, and it targeted German defenses here, on the French coast of Normandy, the widest part of the English Channel, where Adolf Hitler least expected an attack. Despite the advantage of surprise, the Allies faced a powerful adversary, defending one of the strongest sections of the Atlantic Wall. 17 million tons of concrete, more than 1 million tons of steel had been used to build thick bomb-proof bunkers, pillboxes, American soldiers called them, and they were fortified with artillery, mortars, and machine guns trained on the beaches. To crush this fearsome German fortress on the coast of France came the heart of America, its young men. They had been summoned from throughout the nation, youthful champions of freedom gathered from the world's greatest democratic republic, assembled to deliver a blow for liberty from across the waters.
Don't sit under the apple tree with anyone else but me.
Anyone else but me.
Anyone else but me. No, no, no. Don't sit under the apple tree with anyone else but me till I come marching home.
Don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me.
Anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. No, no, no. Don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me till I come marching home.
The airborne troops went in first. The 82nd and 101st Airborne Divisions, paratroopers, who were sent in the dark opening hours of D-Day to capture key bridges, crossroads, and causeways that had to be defended against German reinforcements. Although often outnumbered, they would have to seize and hold their assigned targets until relieved by the main invasion force moving in from the beaches, and they would do it despite serious losses. Five beaches had been carefully selected for the landing sites. American troops would land on two beaches, codenamed Utah and Omaha, while British and Canadian troops would go ashore on Gold, Juno, and Sword beaches. It was a colossal invasion force, 3.5 million Allied troops, 2.5 million tons of equipment, tanks, trucks, jeeps, artillery, 13,000 aircraft, and more than 4,000 ships and landing craft. Among the more than 1 million American servicemen engaged on D-Day was 25-year-old Sergeant Mike Fitch, a farm boy from Lake City, South Carolina, who had worked before the war at the local telephone company. On D-Day, Fitch was attached to the U.S. Army's 29th Infantry Division as a driver and a bodyguard to an intelligence reconnaissance officer named Captain Kenneth Hughes. Their assignment, Fitch and Hughes, was to scout between German and American lines, but first they had to survive the landing on Omaha Beach. That would not be easy. Omaha Beach was dominated by well-constructed, heavily fortified German defenses on a high bluff overlooking the beach. Defenses manned by the 352nd Division, some of the toughest German troops in Normandy. Fitch's landing craft came ashore here, on the far right flank of Omaha Beach, a sector of the beach codenamed Charlie, marked by a high bluff and a beachfront cliff. He landed in the second wave with the 116th Regimental Combat Team. It was shortly after 7 a.m., and Fitch's landing craft followed a first wave company of the 2nd Rangers onto shore. The D-Day landings were made at low tide to avoid German beach obstacles, which meant the troops had to cover 300 yards of open beach under searing artillery, mortar, machine gun, and rifle fire. The casualties on the far right flank of Omaha Beach and Charlie Sector were among the worst of D-Day, and two-thirds of the headquarters company to which Fitch was attached was killed or wounded. Sergeant Mike Fitch survived D-Day and much more combat until the war in Europe ended, but he never forgot those harrowing hours on Omaha Beach. In the summer of 2008, Mike Fitch was living here in Conway, South Carolina, after a long career with the telephone company and a post-retirement position heading up maintenance at Conway's First Baptist Church. He decided to fulfill a lifelong desire to go back to Omaha Beach.
I would like to go back to the battlefield and just see what it was like now. I want to see and look at the places and see how, I can't imagine how we made it. And I want to look and see so I could kind of get an idea of what I went through.
Today, in the French region of Normandy, the events of World War II are remembered with deep emotion. The landscape is still marked in places by the scars of war. Key landmarks from D-Day are preserved as historic sites, and the American liberation of France, which began on D-Day, is still honored by the Norman people. In June of 2008, 64 years after coming ashore on the sands of Normandy under German fire, Mike Fitch arrived in Cherbourg, France. He was greeted with a hero's welcome by a French senator, local dignitaries, and an honor guard of French military veterans.
En Normandie, nous sommes très reconnaissants parce que nous avons été la première partie de la France libérée et nous avons gardé une très grande fidélité et une très grande affection pour les soldats américains. C'est pourquoi vous voyez tous ces porte-drapeaux sont là aujourd'hui pour honorer Monsieur Fitch.
Later, Fitch was driven to St. Mary Glees, site of fierce fighting on D-Day, and there he was honored at a dinner with French veterans. Then, an official escort drove him back to the battlefield, back to Omaha Beach, Charlie Sector, where he had come ashore on June 6, 1944. 64 years earlier, this serene-looking beach had been a bloody battlefield where Mike Fitch and other young American soldiers had waded ashore amid smoke, fire, screams, and explosions. Now, here for the first time since D-Day, all those images came rushing back to this old soldier who had not forgotten those long and deadly hours on this beach.
See, they had machine guns all the way down through here. And when you would come out, if you'd get out here, they could pick you off.
Il y avait les machines allemandes, il y avait les mitrailleuses tout au long.
Yeah, yeah. But it was, it's terrible.
Surrounded now by new French friends who had come in gratitude for all American veterans, Fitch found it difficult to believe he was actually back at Omaha Beach.
I didn't think I would ever see this again. I can still see those bodies laying all over that place out there. Hey, where those people were walking, there was bodies all laying all out there. The engineers had come in here and they were all wiped out. And then the troops started unloading it. And they were just cutting them down just like they were a bush.
And then the moment came when the dignitaries and the escorts were gone, and the old soldier found himself standing alone on the beach, Omaha Beach, thinking, remembering, moved by the present moment and absorbed by the memories of the past.
To see it now, it's very pretty where we went in. But then all you had was pillboxes and machine guns taking care of shooting at us. And that right now, it's just, it's so good to be here and not be shot at. All the way down this beach, as far as you could see bodies laying on the sand and in the water. And the water was all red from blood. And to walk, you had to step over, play a hopscotch to get around. And they were, I'd say about 20 to 25 feet coming out. There was troops all over everywhere. Everywhere you looked, they were dead or wounded.
64 years later, and he remembered the color of the cliffs and the feel of the sand.
And I recognized the sand by just walking on it. If I had been blindfolded, I would have known I was on this beach.
At daylight on D-Day, the Allied naval fleet began bombarding the German defenses on the targeted beaches. Then, like their British and Canadian allies, the American troops bound for Utah and Omaha beaches climbed down into their landing craft and were soon racing through rough seas toward the beaches. Here at Utah Beach, American troops quickly established a beachhead. The patrol boat leading the first wave toward Utah Beach took a direct hit, and the first wave veered off course to land here in the wrong place. The mistake proved to be an advantage. German defenses here were not as formidable. This became Utah Beach, and the U.S. 4th Infantry Division soon secured the beach and pushed inland. To the east of the American landing sites, British and Canadian troops hit their three targeted beaches, Gold, Juno, and Sword, between 7:30 and 8 o'clock in the morning of D-Day. The British 3rd Infantry Division quickly secured Sword Beach and began to fight its way inland in sometimes bitter house-to-house combat. At Juneau Beach, the Canadian 3rd Infantry Division suffered fewer casualties than had been feared and quickly advanced inland. Here at Gold Beach, the British 50th Infantry Division fought its way off the beach and drove the Germans back 8 miles by day's end, the greatest Allied advance of D-Day. One of the toughest targets of D-Day lay here, at Point de Hoc, between the two American beaches. American Army Rangers were charged with scaling Point de Hoc's 100-foot-high cliffs to knock out German artillery that threatened the American beaches. With grappling hooks and ladders, they fought their way to the top with heavy casualties. And here, they found the German guns were gone. They had been moved to the rear, but the Rangers found them and destroyed them. Despite all the successes on Utah, Gold, Juneau, and Sword, all did not go well for the Allies on D-Day, and at one point the invasion seemed in grave danger. A bloody stalemate occurred here on Omaha Beach, where Mike Fitch landed. German defenders were the strongest here, and the American losses were the greatest. Assigned the task of taking Omaha Beach were the U.S. 1st Infantry Division and the 29th Infantry Division. While still in their landing craft, heading toward the beach, they began receiving German fire.
It was scary. We were afraid they were going to unload some artillery inside. We were all very frightened. And you would hear a whisper every now and then, and somebody would say, they're going to get us. And they didn't move. We were all standing very close to each other because we had a load. And when they let the gate down, we thought that was the end. That was the feeling that we all had, that we were going to be killed.
64 years after boarding his landing craft, Mike Fitch sat on the seawall at Omaha Beach and studied a D-Day photograph of American soldiers heading for the beach.
This picture right here is the real thing. That's just like it was out there in the water as we were coming out. This is the troops. That's the way you looked, sat standing inside of this. Everybody was trying to see what is going on ahead of them. And this picture right here, you can get a view of the troops that was in the craft at the time. And we come in from out here, and then they let this gate down. And then we come out of there, you come out kind of like they unload cattle. And you, the water was up to your chin, and it was wet, cold, and very windy.
As an intelligence operative attached that day to the 116th Regiment, Mike Fitch knew only two men aboard his landing craft, Captain Hughes, the intelligence officer he served with, and a Colonel J.J. Matthews of Pennsylvania that he had met in training.
We were on maneuvers over in Northern Ireland, and he was a referee. He called it schemes, we called it maneuvers, and I got to know him. At different times I would see him at regimental headquarters in different outfits. And that's the way I got to know him. And then when he come to see me, he was on a ship and he had spoke to Captain Hughes, and he told him that I was up there on the front of the ship. And then he come to me, and then so we went off on the same craft. And then we went down and we went in the water at the same time.
When his landing craft neared the beach, the ramp came down and the men aboard jumped into the water. Fitch and the two officers were near the front. And as they stepped off the ramp, Colonel Matthews was fatally hit by a German artillery round.
He was on the right of me, about 2 feet behind, and he got a direct hit right in his chest that just blew him all to pieces. His blood went all over me, and the water was full of blood, red. Everywhere you looked, there was red blood on the water.
Today, a landing craft similar to the one that carried Mike Fitch ashore is on display in the D-Day Museum at Omaha Beach. On his return to Normandy, Fitch stood before the surviving boat and recalled the horrendous moments of hitting the beach.
This officer, he got hit about this distance from the craft right by that time. I was right along here, and I'm right there, and all was what stepping off with just a short distance between them, just walking where you could go. A lot of them, the water went over the heads, and some of them were tall enough it was up their chin. But they weren't so deep that they couldn't get out, or somebody pushed them out.
All around him, his fellow soldiers were shot down as they waded through the surf and onto the beach. Fitch and Captain Hughes tried to take cover behind one of the iron obstacles the Germans had erected on the beach. And at the D-Day Museum, Fitch once again found himself behind one of those iron beach obstacles, now a relic of World War II.
I got up, they unloaded me off the craft. This was the first thing that I found to hide behind. I lay down behind this here with a couple of other soldiers, and they were firing at us with machine guns, and it was ricocheting. This is all the protection we had, as you can see. Well, you see, you only have a narrow side, and your body was half hanging over. But the way they were hitting around here and around here, and then it was hitting under here, and it would just fly sideways, going all around.
Like Fitch, many troops in the first and second wave sought whatever cover they could find at water's edge, but the devastating German fire still claimed them in droves. The American tanks that were supposed to provide artillery support had been rigged with flotation devices to get them ashore, but most failed to work, and the majority of tanks sank offshore. A seawall offered the soldiers some protection, and so did the towering cliff walls at Charlie Sector, but both lay across 300 yards of open beach, transformed into killing fields by the German fire. Even so, Fitch and Captain Hughes decided to make a dash for the cliffs.
When you moved, you had to step on a body or you had to jump like playing hopscotch to get around. There were so many dead people. And it just, it was terrible. And I keep it in my mind all the time, and I can't, when I come back here, everything is real again, and I have a feeling that I will never forget to see that the young troops destroyed, just people destroyed, and the Germans up on the hill up here with machine guns and artillery getting everybody off that down there.
Somehow they made it to the base of the cliffs, which still rise abruptly above modern Omaha Beach. The Germans atop the bluff could not depress their machine guns enough to hit the base of the sheer cliff wall. So Fitch, Captain Hughes, and some other soldiers huddled there in temporary shelter.
I felt like we were closed in a cage because we were protected. That was my feeling. I could look around and I didn't see any German equipment laying anywhere around. So we felt secure, and you could look back up the load, the crafts that was unloading, and you could see the troops falling, and they were all down the shore down through here. There were dead soldiers and wounded soldiers, and we were staying where the enemy couldn't see us. Some of the troops were shot and their stomach was all torn out. It had a terrible odor, and it would start vomiting, no way you could keep it. It's one of the worst odors that I think that any human being could ever encounter, because when the stomach was torn up, it was just all scattered around, and you had to stay a distance from them. They washed up the shore, and a lot of soldiers that had been shot or drowned would wash up here, and you couldn't walk without walking on them, and it was blood everywhere. The water was red, and it was, you knew it was human beings, and it gives you a feeling that you were worried, when they're gonna get me.
In the dark early hours of D-Day, American commandos had been dropped by parachute near the beach with orders to destroy selected targets. One of the paratroopers had been blown off course and had landed at the base of the cliff on Omaha Beach. Mike Fitch found the soldier wrapped in his parachute at the base of the cliff, where he had been trapped by enemy fire.
And I can remember it was just like yesterday, this morning, because I remember very clearly where I was at. And we found a soldier laying at the bottom there that had his parachute didn't let him get upstairs. And he pointed out to us where the machine guns up there were. And he said, if you get out a distance, they can lower it down on you, but if you stay here, he said, I've been right against the wall since in the nighttime. And he said, if you walk out 10 feet, they can get you. They said, and he talked, then he got up with us, and once we settled down there, and the captain was telling us, so he was telling us to stay against the bank and don't very, very far away. He said, I'm gonna be looking out.
Fitch and the other soldiers at the base of the cliff quickly learned there was no safe place on Omaha Beach on D-Day. The Germans on the bluff above began tossing hand grenades onto the Americans below.
They were throwing hand grenades. They were coming down with hand grenades because the machine guns were set to go out here. And they couldn't shoot. Now, if you walk out here 10 or 15 feet, they could pick you off. And they had one right back up here, and he could shoot in this angle here, but he couldn't get back this way because his gun wouldn't go back that way. But they had it where they had it figured out. They could get you in most any place you go, and they were doing a good job at doing that too.
On the bluff near Fitch's position was a fortified German pillbox mounting a 75-millimeter artillery piece and topped by a machine gun nest. It could not be seen by most of the U.S. warships off Omaha Beach, and it continued to unleash deadly fire at American landing craft, tanks, and troops. The Germans called it Fortification WN-73. Mike Fitch and the other troops at the base of the cliff did not know the pillbox's name. They just knew it was killing Americans, and they decided to attack it.
This officer told us to see what it was and see what we could do. And we walked to that corner, and that we were trying to, there was two of us go at the time, and we would throw hand grenades, then we would run back this way, come back to where we started. And then we kept doing that for about an hour, hour and a half, and then we got run short of hand grenades. So we decided to go back and shoot the walls where we could see and make the shot ricochet and go in on them. We were trying anything that you could think of so we could pick them off.
As Fitch and the other soldiers fought their battle against the pillbox overlooking Omaha Beach, more American troops were landed on the beach, and they also were pinned down by the heavy German fire coming from the bluffs. Back at Allied headquarters in London, General Dwight D. Eisenhower, the Allied commander, received reports of the bloody stalemate on Omaha Beach and worried that the invasion was in jeopardy. He knew that somehow the Americans on Omaha Beach had to break through the formidable German defenses. Finally, after hours of desperate fighting, the breakthrough came on the afternoon of D-Day, thanks to two crucial battlefield developments. Seeing one wave of troops after another pinned down on the beach by German fire from the bluffs, the commanders of the American destroyers off Omaha Beach courageously ran their ships close to shore, almost going aground, and blasted the German defenses from close range, destroying many of them.
They were trying to pick those top cliffs off right up there, and they were just skimming the top of it. And we were afraid they were going to hit. But they didn't do that. They had them zeroed in where they were just skimming the top up there. And you could, every now and then you could see the dirt fly up as you were looking up, which we did a lot of time.
Soon after the American warships reduced the German artillery fire, a handful of surviving American tanks began moving from one German pillbox to another, firing into them at point-blank range, knocking them out one by one. One German installation the tanks attacked was WN-73, which Mike Fitch and his companions had been battling unsuccessfully for hours.
The tanks come in, and they took care of everything in there. It was completely silent. There was nobody alive.
When Mike Fitch returned to the battlefield, one of the first D-Day sites he recognized was that German pillbox, WN-73, the bunker he and other infantrymen had tried so hard to destroy on D-Day. Today, it still towers over Charlie Sector of Omaha Beach, and it bears scars of the battle to take it.
You could see it. They were firing. We knew it was here because they were firing out of here and hitting those tanks that was trying to get in. And then we knew that there was machine guns right up above our head. And then when we finally got to the over here, we started trying to get hand grenades in here, and we could see. We could hit that corner hoping that it would ricochet back in there, but it wasn't. The gun in there was protecting the people back there. And then when we ran out of hand grenades, we started using M1s or whatever we had, and we were shooting right up here. I can see where the shots were right up there, just like it was yesterday. I can see right the spots there. Hitting that, we thought they would ricochet. And if they were doing any good, I don't know, but we were doing it anyway. You couldn't stand down there and do nothing. You had to try to do something.
Then the old soldier ducked inside the historic pillbox and placed his finger in bullet holes that may have come from his rifle fire. As they received support from the destroyers and the surviving tanks, the troops on Omaha Beach began fighting their way off the beach and up the high ground that overlooked it. Finally, at great cost, the beach that would become known as Bloody Omaha belonged to the Americans, and the landings on all five Allied beaches were now a success. Meanwhile, Mike Fitch, Captain Hughes, and several other soldiers decided to scale the high cliffs at Charlie Sector with a human ladder. Up they went, climbing man over man until they reached the top and were hit by a spray of German rifle fire.
I was the third one to go up, and they were laying down up there. And the first one went up, they knocked him out. They got him from a distance and they killed him. The next one went up, he took care of the one that got that one, because he knew where it was coming from. So that when we finally got up, we got the last man up there. We were lined up and pulling, laying down and reached down to pull that one.
Today, a monument marks the center of Omaha Beach. And D-Day veteran Mike Fitch stood before it, remembering the images, the noise, the smells, the faces, and counting the cost of victory. Through Omaha and the other captured beachheads, Allied troops and equipment poured into France. But the fighting was far from over. The country lanes behind Omaha and the other beaches were flanked by hedgerows, walls of thick hedges that had separated the fields and pastures of Normandy for ages. Surrounded on four sides by hedgerows, each field, every pasture, was potentially a well-defended fortress from which German troops could ambush the advancing Americans. Here in the hedgerow country behind Omaha Beach, on the late afternoon of D-Day, Mike Fitch had his first face-to-face encounter with the enemy.
We come to the hedgerow, and I was looking, and I saw a man move over on the other side. And then he was trying to pick me off, and he was getting a good spot to shoot me. And then I saw his head and hard helmet show up. And I shot right then, and then I saw that helmet fly off his head. I was scared, and I knew that if I didn't get him right this minute, he would get me. And I felt better about myself. I felt more secure that once I had got one, and that I wasn't as nervous anymore, because I looked for him to get. But this was the one that was looking at me, and I was very scared. And when I fired, I knew I had done it. Then I had a different feeling toward what I was doing. A first time kill, it makes a big difference in your life.
One more time on this return visit, the old soldier traveled the lanes through the hedgerows, searching for a Norman cottage with an adjacent barn and shed. He found it finally, a couple of miles in the rear of Omaha Beach. It was to this place, he was sure, that he had come in the fading daylight hours of D-Day with Captain Hughes and two other soldiers. Something told them to check the shed beside the house, and Fitch volunteered to do it, an act that almost cost him his life.
We come up on this house right here, and we decided to take a check on the stable that was back of the house here. And I opened the door to look, and I got hit in the head with the butt of a rifle, and I fell, and the German was going to stick a bayonet in me. As I rolled over, I looked up and the bayonet was coming toward me, and the American soldier was standing right there, and he shot the German, and the German fell across me and the bayonet stuck over on the dirt.
Mike Fitch was engaged in combat until the end, serving most of the time in the dangerous duty of field intelligence with Captain Hughes, surviving extensive fighting and hand-to-hand combat, surviving wounds, and going back into battle. Like other American veterans, he focused on surviving one day at a time.
I always had a sick feeling in your stomach. Somebody's gonna get me. And you were alert at all times, looking, listening, and seeing any bush move, you take notice to see what it was. And that's, you couldn't make too much time because you had to go slow and listen, because they could slip in on you and you would not know it until they were right at you. You were scared 24 hours a day. That's the way it was.
As American and Allied forces fought their way across Europe, there were setbacks, surprises, severe losses. But they kept advancing, driving back Nazi forces across France, Holland, Belgium, Germany. And finally, on May 8, 1945, came VE Day, victory in Europe. The enemy was conquered, Hitler was dead, and Nazi Germany surrendered. In the Pacific, more bloody months of fighting would follow until VJ Day, August 15, 1945, the Allied victory over Japan. But in May of 1945, the war in Europe ended. Mike Fitch heard the news about the German surrender while he was in Czechoslovakia.
Come on the news that the Germans had surrendered. We were in Czechoslovakia, right at Prague, following the tanks to the way they closed in at. And that's the way we ended up, right in the middle of it. I went from Omaha Beach to Prague, Czechoslovakia.
Eventually, most American visitors to Normandy find their way here, to the American cemetery overlooking Omaha Beach. Here, organized in the shape of a Latin cross, lie the remains of more than 9,000 American troops who made the ultimate sacrifice while fighting to liberate Europe. Towering over the cemetery is a bronze statue entitled "The Spirit of American Youth Rising from the Waves." From the cemetery bluff, visitors can gaze at the seascape horizon from which America's young men came to liberate Europe, overcome evil, and preserve freedom. Like all veterans who come back to Normandy, Mike Fitch wanted to visit the American cemetery and see the final resting place for his comrades in arms. Cemetery officials welcomed this old soldier. And there, in the American cemetery, Mike Fitch found a grave for a Colonel J.J. Matthews of Pennsylvania. Was it the same man who had befriended him moments before dying on D-Day?
In my mind, this is the man that I know right here. There's no way I can tell any difference, but it's the same name and from the same state. So that's why I'm not reasonably sure. I'm sure this is got to be the one. This is somebody I knew. And he's here in this grave. And even though I only knew him on business, and I have a deep feeling. He was a brother in service. And that's the way all of us soldiers were. we were brothers all the way through.
An American veteran back on the battlefield 64 years later, reliving an epic event that was both historic and personal.
Weather and the sand, everything brings everything right back to you, even though the houses are built here, but still have that memory of the sand, how hard it was, and how the wind blowing. It just brings it all right back in your mind, and you got it in here, you can't get it out. It comes right back to you. I don't think anybody's ever been on this beach during that time. If he's still alive, he still has that memory in his side of him. And it's very touching. And I'm just proud that I was an American and a part of this.
His story, like that of all his comrades, now belongs to all Americans, as do all the extraordinary achievements of that greatest generation, the Americans in uniform of World War II, who have come now to represent American veterans of all eras. They and the civilians of their generation who forged the tools that won the war have established for those who follow a model of courage, sacrifice, selflessness, and patriotism. An enduring legacy of fidelity to the values represented by that banner of broad stripes and bright stars, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God.